Good day to you, sir.
That young man, what's his name?
Him? Everybody knows him. That's Tintin.
Chances are, if you're not Belgian, French, or Spanish, you're only vaguely familiar with Tintin. The series was one of the most popular European comics of the 20th century, and followed intrepid reporter Tintin and his little dog Milou, named Snowy by the uncultured English swines, in his adventures across the globe. He was generally accompanied by Captain Haddock, a brash and strong-mouthed sea captain. But Mr. Narrator, I hear you say. If this series of comics was so successful, why didn't anyone try to turn it into a film? Well, that's because they did. Many times. They just weren't very successful, mostly relegated to low budgets or just being average films. However, in 2011, something happened. Steven Spielberg, the creator of the modern blockbuster, genius of whimsy and adventure films, joined forces with Peter Jackson, the guy behind, only the greatest film trilogy of all time, got a script co-written by Edgar Wright and enlisted the brilliant musical genius that is John Williams, and they made The Adventures of Tintin, The Secret of the Unicorn. The film was a commercial success, grossing $375 million on a budget of $135, and was received warmly by critics and audiences alike, with many comparing it to Spielberg's Raiders of the Lost Ark. Yet, to me, I've always felt this movie never got the attention it deserved. Not only did it have one of the most kick-ass creative teams behind it, based on a source material that is astoundingly entertaining, with a spectacular cast helming it, but it's also just one of the most fun movies I can think of. So, in this video essay thing, I'm going to explain to you why this film deserves way more credit than it gets. Let's start off with some history. Created in 1929 by Belgian cartoonist Hergé, Tintin was a series of comic strips originally published in Le Petit Vingtaine, which eventually became its own series of comics. The main character was Tintin, a young reporter and adventurer who was sort of like a young Indiana Jones. He traveled the world with his faithful dog Snowy and got himself into adventures and mysteries. Other notable characters include Captain Haddock, the foul-mouthed alcoholic sea captain, Thompson and Thompson, two bumbling useless Interpol agents, and sometimes Professor Calculus, an absent-minded and mostly deaf inventor. Tintin has been adapted to pretty much every form of entertainment, including two animated series in 1957 and 1991, a few radio dramas, and five feature-length films, one in stop-motion, two in live-action, and two in traditional animation. And so, for the majority of the 20th century and the early 21st century, Tintin remained a pop culture icon only in the European countries that he was based in. But that all changed in 1981. Honestly, the way this film came about is just amazing to me. Let's flash back to 1981. Raiders of the Lost Ark is in theaters, and it's quite successful. Spielberg is riding high and reading reviews of his action-adventure masterpiece, because the guy's entitled to celebrate, you know? And some French review keeps saying, "Oh, dude, this film is totally like Tintin." And Spielberg is like, "What the cinnamon toast crunch is Tintin?" And so he discovers the series of books. So Stevie Boy here is immediately hooked, alright? And he goes, "Oh man, oh boy, yeah. I need to make this into a movie." Turns out Hergé, who at the time was still alive, was a huge fan of Spielberg himself. They scheduled to meet in 1983, while Spielberg was filming Temple of Doom. Unfortunately, complications arose when Hergé, died the week that was supposed to happen. Awkward. Thankfully, his wife decided to give them the rights anyway. And then, the project went into development hell. Spielberg was unsatisfied with the scripts, the rights went back to the Hergé Foundation, Warner Bros. Wanted a shot at it. Spielberg considered the option to make it an animated film under his DreamWorks company. It was a whole thing. Eventually, in 2004, Spielberg reverted back to his choice for a live-action adaptation, and called up Peter Jackson to ask if Weta Digital, the guys behind the VFX for Lord of the Rings, could make a computer-generated Snowy. And here's where it gets fun. It turns out that Peter Jackson was a lifelong fan of Tintin and had been aching to do an adaptation himself. So he went, "Nah, dude, you gotta do it motion capture." So long story short, they settled for a motion capture adaptation. Spielberg initially invited Edgar Wright to write the film, but Wright was busy, so he recommended Stephen Moffat, who wrote a draft but had to leave to become the head writer of Doctor Who.
"Come on! The Doctor will see you now!"
They managed to get Edgar Wright back, and he wrote two drafts along with a certain Joe Cornish. Then Wright left to make Scott Pilgrim, and Cornish finished the final draft. They eventually started filming in 2009, with Spielberg in the directing position and Jackson as a producer. However, it was more of a co-directing partnership, with Spielberg handling the filming and the shoots, and Jackson handling the effects work at Weta Digital. The cast was stellar, too. They had Billy Elliot's Jamie Bell as Tintin, motion capture god Andy Serkis as Captain Haddock, Daniel Craig as the villain in his second coolest performance after Knives Out, I might add, Nick Frost and Simon Pegg as Thompson and Thompson, which is just amazing. And finally, in October of 2011, Tintin entered theaters, and the life of a young, extremely handsome, and talented film lover was changed forever. So, let's move on to why I think this film is so criminally underrated. The visuals. Tintin counts as a noir film. It's such a strange thing to say. There are very few children's films that I can really classify as noir. The only one that really comes to mind is Roger Rabbit, and maybe The Incredibles has elements of noir, but nothing to this extent. The film is drenched in the dark shadows and smoky atmospheres. The lighting is harsh and atmospheric, with light beams breaking through the dust. The cinematography is very moody at times, especially coupled with John Williams' stellar soundtrack. Then again, it also counts as an adventure film. The comparisons to Indiana Jones are very understandable. The action scenes are tight and inventive, the story moves in a globe-trotting story around the world to uncover the mystery of the lost treasure. This was Spielberg's first foray into motion capture, and he really went all in. The visuals are great adaptations of the original source material, capturing the style and the colors and adding, well, dimension to them. You can see that Spielberg is really having a lot of fun with the control that shooting motion capture provides. There's a polish to the presentation of the film that's just hard to put into words, but really noticeable. There really is no other film like it. Also, props to the opening credits for being the best opening credits since Catch Me If You Can. This film just feels like a blend of all the great things that Spielberg is good at. The action and adventure from Indiana Jones, the noir and credit sequence of Catch Me If You Can, the atmosphere and whimsy of E.T., then you got Peter Jackson just heaping in a good helping of stellar VFX, Mr. Williams dropping his sweet tracks, and then, just to add that little pinch of cinnamon on top, we got a truckload of awesome scene transitions. This film just puts me in a good mood, and that's in part thanks to the characters. Tintin is awesome in this film. That's kind of weird to say, because in the original comics, Tintin suffered a major case of overcompetence. He was a bit of a Gary Sue, pretty much always being able to work himself out of a situation in no time. In his first ever issue, he crashed a plane and made a replacement propeller out of a tree, and his only mistake was that he made it backwards and had to do it again to flawless results. He's the humble brag king. This film doesn't really fix that issue per se.
Relax! I interviewed a pilot once!
But Jamie Bell brings such an energy to the character that it really doesn't matter. Tintin is portrayed as an optimistic, plucky reporter, yeah, but there's a side of near obsession to it that's very engaging.
The Haddock line is cursed.
What else have you found out?
What is there to find?
That depends what you're looking for.
I'm looking for answers.
You get the feeling he enjoys the thrill of the chase more than the actual solution. It's very Sherlock.
What is it about this ship? Why has it attracted so much attention? What secrets do you hold?
And then, hot take, Andy Serkis as Captain Haddock might be a better comic book casting than Mark Hamill as the Joker.
I'd stand back if I were you.
Jesus! Everybody out of the room!
Sorry. I'm never sure which I prefer, but Serkis has done the same thing that Hamill did with the Joker. When I was a kid, I never considered that Captain Haddock might have an accent. You don't really read into that sort of thing on the page. Yet now, every time I read a Tintin comic, I hear Andy Serkis.
Froglodytes!
Captain, get down!
Slave breeders! Mutant malingerers! Freshwater! Politicians!
The same goes for Jamie as well. These have become the definitive versions of the characters in my mind. This film excellently pulls the core aspects of the characters into the light and then leaves just a little bit of leeway for the actors to put their own spin on it. It's just a showcase of good writing and directing. Plus, the chemistry they have is fantastic.
I know your game. You're one of them.
Sorry?
They sent you here to kill me, huh?
Look, I don't know who you are!
That only a true Haddock can discover the secret of the unicorn.
I don't remember anything about anything.
But you must know about your ancestors. Sir Francis, it's your family legacy.
My memory is not what it used to be.
But what did it used to be?
I've forgotten.
The script. Speaking of the writing, like I said before, this film is a melding of action-adventure and mystery-noir. I'll spare you the details of the actual plot, because while it's not something that can be spoiled, per se, I don't really think it matters that much. You just have to know that it's very well-paced and very engaging. This movie doesn't require a lot of concentration, yet it's always engaging to you. The thing this movie heavily pushes in every aspect is fun. Do you remember when movies were just fun? They didn't have to be part of a large franchise or be artistic for the sake of it. This is a classic adventure blockbuster film that can just be enjoyed for what it is. The characters are fun. The set pieces are fun. The jokes are fun. The villain is fun. The slapstick is fun. The cinematography is fun. It's just fun. It reminds me a lot of films like Mask of Zorro or the first Pirates of the Caribbean. They don't have to be deep, they're not too complex, they're just fun for the sake of it. And that's harder to pull off than it seems. This script is tight. No scene goes to waste. I've heard complaints that Thompson and Thompson are a bit unnecessary, but you have to understand that these are classic Tintin mainstays. They needed to be in the film. It'd be like making The Lord of the Rings without Merry and Pippin. Plus, there's Simon Pegg and Nick Frost, so you can't really complain.
Great Scotland Yard! Oh, that's extraordinary!
What is?
Worthington's have a half-price sale on bowler hats.
Really, Thompson? This is hardly the time. Great Scotland Yard!
What is it? Kane's a half-price too?
You... Sure, they don't necessarily add much to the story, but they're harmless and they are quite funny. Like I said, this film is just enjoyable to watch. Every time I've started watching it, I always watch it the whole way through. It took me much longer than it should have to write this because I just kept watching. I could keep going on for hours, but honestly, this is my first video essay and I'm tired. So next time you're looking for something to watch, why not try Tintin? Give it a look and let me know what you think.
All's well that ends well.
Oh, hey, you made it to the end of the video. Kinda didn't expect for you to get this far. I mean, I'd recommend watching another of my videos, but I don't have any. Oh, here, have a crazy good analysis of Pirates of the Caribbean by somebody completely different. Alright, so long. Bye.